Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Welcome, as we've gathered here this morning to remember the life of Gerald Mee and to ask God to comfort and strengthen us as together we celebrate the gift that his life was to each one of us and share the pain that his passing brings. As we remain standing, I invite you to bow your heads as we pray for our own faith and its outworking in our lives. Heavenly Father, in your Son Jesus Christ, you have set before us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen. Please be seated. Our first Bible reading is taken from Psalm 23. This is a psalm written by King David. And the Bible describes David as a man after God's own heart. And what David is doing in this psalm is he's describing the God who created him, who created Gerald, who has created each one of us, the God whom David has come to know and to love. And this is what he writes. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. So we stand now to sing our first hymn, all of which have been chosen by Gerald, O Thou Who Camest From Above.
Think for thee, still let
So please be seated for our second Bible reading, which is taken from the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And when I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. Henceforth, you know him and have seen him." It's helpful to remember as we're gathered here this morning that each of you has brought with you today your own particular memories of Gerald, your own unique memories of him, of the ways in which his life has touched and perhaps changed yours, of the times that you spent with him and he with you. And whenever someone we love, someone close to us, someone we've known for a long time dies, it reminds us of the fact that for each one of us, this earthly life must one day come to an end, and of the mystery of the gift of life. And often too, we may look into our hearts and bring to the surface really important questions about what hope we have for the future and what we believe happens after we die. Jesus, in our gospel reading, was very clear about the fact that this life is by no means all that there is, and that through faith, death is not the end, but the gateway into the new life of his eternal kingdom. As we reflect on his words, we can draw strength and comfort as we turn to the one who made us all, knowing that he understands our sadness, that he reaches out to meet us and to stand with us in the midst of it, and to gather us up in our sorrow with his comfort and his love. So as we think back over Gerald's life this morning, I want to encourage each of you to take those good memories that you have of him, to bring them before God with thanksgiving, and also to be open to receive from him. I'm now going to invite Professor Ray Johnson to come and bring us the eulogy. Thank you.
Good morning. Gerald was born at number 4 Market Place, Leek, on Saturday, the 10th of October, 1925. He was christened, as you know, Gerald Rudyard Struan Mee. Gerald from his grandfather, Rudyard from his father, and Struan from his father's best friend, Struan Craig Mackenzie, who was his godfather. His grandparents had lived in Africa since 1898 and came back to England in 1915 so that their son, Gerald's father, could enlist in the army as an 18-year-old. During the war, they ran the Red Lion Hotel in Leek, but grandfather died in the 1918 flu epidemic, and Granny Anne bought the hotel and ran it until 1946. As a baby, Gerald was filmed by his father with a Pathé baby camera he bought that year, 1925. And Gerald kept that camera all his life and those early films, and began using the camera himself as a boy. During his school days in Leek, his father was continually making films during the 1930s, and these are all preserved and can still be enjoyed today. While at high school, he remembers mobilizing with fellow pupils in 1939 to stick brown paper on the school windows in case of bombing raids and taking turns at fire watching. In 1940, he became a cycle messenger boy at Air Raid Precautions HQ in Leek Town Hall. And in the same year, started the Leek Amateur Cine Society with his friend John Cartwright. They showed their films around Leek and elsewhere to raise money for the local Spitfire Fund, for the YMCA war effort, and for Mrs. Churchill's Aid to Russia Fund. At 18, in 1943, he joined the Royal Observer Corps, and he was posted at Nan 3 near Rushton Spencer. To help him get about, he managed to buy a Ford 8 car for £40. The only threat to his parents at home during the war was an incendiary bomb which dropped in their backyard. At the end of the war, he went to London University's School of Pharmacy in Bloomsbury Square. After graduating, Gerald got his call up for national service in January 1948 and joined the RAF. After initial training in Bridgnorth, he was posted overseas with the rank of sergeant. Now he began to see more of the world. He spent 9 months in Egypt's Canal Zone at the headquarters of the Middle East Air Force in Abu Zuir, then a further 7 months at a medical stores depot at Luka Airport in Malta. He visited almost all the depots and stations in the Suez Canal Zone and was in contact with the stations we supplied in Iraq, Greece, Cyprus, and Malta with its subsidiary airports in Libya, Tripoli, Benghazi, and Tobruk. This really was the start of his great interest in foreign travel. After national service, he was articled to John Martin at his pharmacy in Leek. John was himself an accomplished filmmaker and friend of Gerald's father. Besides mentoring Gerald in pharmacy, he greatly helped Gerald develop his photography and especially cinematography. Over the decades, Gerald's films and videos of Leek, the Leek area, and Staffordshire Moorlands have created an important and wonderful archive. In 1950, he joined the Stoke-on-Trent Amateur Cine Society, eventually becoming president in 1973. For many years, they had regular meetings at the Queen's Hotel in Basford, whose upstairs community room was converted into a permanent film studio and appears as various locations in virtually all their films at that time. He joined the Institute of Amateur Cinematographers, the IAC, in 1954, and served on the National Council from 1967 onwards. And here we see the coming together and crystallization of all the aspects and elements that made Gerald that many-faceted gem of a gentleman that we all knew. Alongside his long and successful pharmaceutical career, the Globetrotter, visiting many countries and witnessing historical changes in those countries. The consummate filmmaker, winning national and international trophies and awards. President and officer of many filmmaking associations, chairman and president of the IAC, director of the IAC International Film and Video Festival, associate of the Royal Photographic Society, fellow of the IAC, fellow of the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, fellow of the Royal Society of Arts, Freeman of the City of London, member of the Most Excellent Order of the British Empire. And so, a man of immense accomplishment in his creative and administrative roles, and a man of immense heart in his advice, help, and friendship with such a wide circle of people and communities. When I first started working in film as a young lecturer at Staffordshire Polytechnic, later Staffordshire University, I used film in projects with students. I had full-time, part-time, and day-release students. There were no filmmaking facilities or a film course at that time. I'd found a 16mm cine camera, the same as the one you saw in the black-and-white photo of Gerald holding a reel up on the screen, one of those Bolex cameras, in the stores of the mining department, surplus to requirements, and a stock of unused, going-out-of-date, black-and-white film in cans, surplus to requirements, and once used for time and motion studies with the students. I got permission to use it with day-release mining students. I borrowed a portable reel-to-reel tape recorder from Radio Stoke and somehow managed to edit together film footage of the students' local mines, with every one of them having a go with the camera, and recordings of their comments of the daily routine of going on shift to make a 10-minute film I called Shift. And I still show it, as it's now a valuable archive, since the miners' daily routine of going on shift finished over 20 years ago. The big learning curve for me was making a first long film, then getting commissions to make longer films. And I learned the importance of collaboration and organization on a larger scale, and my great mentor was Gerald. Not only in his generous advice, but in his explanation of logistics and actual filming for inclusion in my productions. We got into a routine of filming together on shoots where two or more cameras were needed, or independently, he could do location filming of stock footage where he chose the days to film in good weather while I concentrated on interviews and editing. Our very first collaboration with Gerald, myself, and John Cunningham of Leek filming for a film I then edited and produced was secretly entered into an IAC competition by Gerald, and it won the Best Northwest Film Award. In recent years, it was chosen by the BFI for the Britain on Film section on its website, and it's on there now for free viewing. I also began doing voiceovers and presenting for Gerald's own films, recording commentaries at his home and presenting to camera on location. And that continued for many years. And the very most recent, about 2 or 3 years ago, the subject was, Leek. He invited me to join the judging panel for IAC competitions, with judging taking place over a weekend at Gerald's house, different groups of judges in different rooms, then all together for final discussions and a wonderful spread that he put out for our tea, with the legendary Spam Fritters always a feature. And later, I joined him on the judging panel for the British International Amateur Film Festival, BIAF, which is still running, and this year will be held in Birmingham the weekend after this coming weekend, the last 2 years being online and virtual. All in all, in terms of filmmaking, for me, Gerald has always been there, a passionate filmmaker and a preserver of his film and video heritage. A source of encyclopedic film information and a source of unquestioning support, with my unquestioning support in return. If Gerald asked for some help, it was done. It was done, I hope, with enthusiasm, and it was done with love. Gerald created a brief account of his life with his friend Trevor Siggers some years ago. Sadly, Trevor can't be here today, having tested positive a couple of days ago. They updated it in 2018, and on this update, Gerald attached at the end a birthday card he'd received from his grandma, Anne Carding Lee, on his 8th birthday in 1933. He'd kept it all those years. And I'd like to conclude with this handwritten message on that birthday card. It's an anonymous poem some of you may know. To Gerald, on your birthday. Count your garden by the flowers, never by the leaves that fall. Count your days by golden bowers, don't remember clouds at all. Count your night by stars, not shadows. Count your life with smiles, not tears. And with joy on this your birthday, count your age by friends, not years. Count your age by friends, not years. Well, by that philosophy, and with Gerald, you would quickly lose count. And I'm proud to have been one of Gerald's countless friends. Thank you, Gerald.
So I'm now going to invite the Reverend John Gleaves to bring his tribute to Gerald and read us two more poems. Thank you, John.
Part of this address, I thank the Reverend Alan Townshend, who helped and gave me some advice on the early years of Gerald. I joined Stoke-on-Trent Amateur Cine Society in the autumn of 1975. I had been to one or two of the shows the Society presented at the Reginald Mitchell Theatre in Hanley. I was impressed with a film that Gerald showed and had made, how Christmas was not only a time for the young people to enjoy themselves, but also the elderly of our community in a more social way. It showed his family and friends gathered around the Christmas table, enjoying themselves and pulling crackers. Also, I went to the showing of the 10 best films and top 8 films, shows which Stoke once again gave at the Mitch. I enjoyed these evenings and decided to become a member of Stoke. The club room, as Ray had already said, was in the Queen's Hotel, Basford. And to reach the room, one climbed the stairs, at the top of which was a door with the name of the Cine Society prominently displayed. I heard laughter and chattering from within, and the room, as I pushed open the door, fell silent. What seemed like 1,000 eyes followed me as I stepped further into the room. I stopped. Then someone said in a gentle, reassuring voice, "Hello, have you come to join us?" I answered in the affirmative, and I was welcomed beyond measure. I recall that as the evening progressed, I had met Gerald Mee, who always greeted me with that same smile and reassuring voice, which greeted me some 47 years long. Anyone who stood in Gerald's presence was standing in the presence of a true gentleman. He was always courteous and welcoming, and he made people feel comfortable in his presence. Thus he was always well known through his manner and his demeanor. Gerald always knew the right sense to wear for the occasion. He knew when to wear formal dress. Especially for a special occasion, he wore dinner dress, and he knew when to wear a lounge suit. Indeed, dress sense was very important to him. On most occasions when I met him, he was tidily dressed in neat clothing, and there was always that smile about which I have already mentioned. And I have it on good authority that this morning Gerald is dressed in his dinner jacket and his suit, his shoes, his tie, and his socks. Speak to any person who knew and was a close acquaintance of Gerald, and two words immediately come to the fore. One is kindness, the other is generosity. His kindness was readily shown in his willingness to help, either in giving advice or lending some of his equipment to help members make a film. His generosity was shown when, until recently, he opened his house for 2 days so that members of the society could set up games inside the house and also in the garden. This was the Cine Society's fundraising occasion to make money for the society and its activities. The garage was used as a shooting stall when 2 air rifles were used to shoot at targets. Gerald would have a go on every game, once, twice, or even 3 times. His kitchen, crockery and cutlery were used, and Gerald did not mind in the slightest. Mrs. Horner, whom people may know, was in charge of the catering for the evening, whilst her husband assisted in the organisation of the event. Gerald was very friendly with the Horner family. Gerald certainly was a true Leakensian and joined in, if not organised, activities for the citizens of the town. Such tasks he enjoyed doing. He was caring and supportive towards people who were experiencing difficulties. He was simply interested in people, and I am sure that many Leakensians know him as a leading citizen of the town. Jeff, one of Gerald's close friends and helper, told me that if ever he wanted to know anything, he would ask Gerald, who would advise and help him. Such was Gerald's wide knowledge. My wife and he collected crested teaspoons, which he has on display on his walls, and a very impressive display it is. My wife has her teaspoons in similar cases, and when they meet together, there is always discussion on any recent teaspoons which he or she may have bought. When I decided to be ordained, after I had retired from teaching, Gerald took a great interest in my work towards ordination, which included a theology degree. And upon my priesting, some 2 or 3 years later, he asked if I would take part in his funeral service. In fact, I readily agreed. I saw Gerald as a person with a deep faith. I was with him at an Institute of Amateur Cinematographers weekend in Malvern, and on the Sunday morning, he, my wife, and I went to the early communion service in the abbey there. This church was his family church, and Gerald was baptized here. Indeed, the family was a benefactor to St. Edward's. Whilst he was away in London, training to qualify as a pharmacist, he attended the well-known Church of All Saints, Margaret Street, close to Oxford Circus. And attending this church gave him an insight into the Catholic wing of the Church of England, and which he continues to appreciate. It may well have been All Saints with his high standard of music which led him to develop a keen interest in Catholic organ and church music. He was involved in the Friends of Cathedral He was involved in Friends of Cathedral music. He later took keen interest in the North Staffordshire organ, took organ lessons, and became a trustee of the Friends of Victoria Hall organ. Having qualified as a pharmacist, he returned to Leek, working and becoming a member partner with Duncan Ross, who had four branches in this area and around the potteries. The firm sold cameras, and this stimulated Gerald's love of photography, which interested him when he introduced it to the Stoke-on-Trent Cine Society. And he also enjoyed being part of that with John Martin, who had a camera shop in Hanley. As time developed, he put his interests to photography and cine photography to good use, recording many events in and around his family home and the potteries. His camera recorded royal events of the visits to potteries of the Queen and like, and when they came to Etruria, and he recorded also the garden festival in Etruria. He readily visited the new Vic Theatre in Newcastle, not only to see the productions, but also to have a meal with his friends on most Tuesdays. His knowledge of the area was vast, and he contributed many interesting articles to The Way We Were, telling how people lived in past times. Gerald had interest in the arts of the area, attending historical and civic events. He was a member of Probus, and for many years he was chairman of the Film Theatre in Stoke. He took an active part in the talking newspapers here in Leek, a service which many people enjoyed as they learnt of the local news. He enjoyed being part of the organisation which he belonged. Each of us, as Nigel said, has our memories of him, and we are grateful for being part of his family and he of ours. He was rewarded for all that he did when he was honoured with receiving the MBE. On that day, he made Leek proud. Indeed, our lives are richer for knowing him. St. John, at the end of his Gospel, writes, "But there are also many other things which Jesus did. Were every one of them to be written, I suppose the whole world could not contain the books that would be written." Gerald led a full life, as we've heard, and with reference to St. John's closing words, "There may have been many other things which Gerald did, about which we are unaware." May he rest in peace and rise in glory. Now, there's always something which Gerald did. He was always a man who used to have fun and enjoy things. And when you could see that he was being a bit mischievous, there was that twinkle in his eye which is on the front of our service sheets today. And he wished to have this piece read. It's by Joyce Grenfell at his funeral service. "When I go, talk not in a Sunday voice. Weep if you must. Parting's hell. But laugh as well." And then he wanted another poem read, which is simply called "Far Away." "Although you cannot see me, I'm not far away. I'm in your mind and memories today and every day. So dry your eyes and weep no more. Treasure what we had before. Smile when you remember the jokes we had. Try not to feel so lonely or sad. Life will go on without me. That's how it's meant to be. So make the most of it. For life is running through, you know." Let my life be your strength and anchor each and every day. Each and every day. To help you through this journey that will come extreme one day. Be glad for the time spent together, for the love we shared through the years. Be happy now and wipe away those tears. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Okay. Thanks very much.
Thank you, John. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. Although he causes grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. The Bible tells us that we are all made in the image of God as we open its pages at the beginning of the book of Genesis. It goes on to explain that that image is imperfect in each one of us because we all do things wrong, which is why we all need God's forgiveness and help. But despite our human imperfections, there are still reflections in everyone's life of the image of the one who made us. And we can see a number of these in Gerald's life. His sociable character, his gentle manner, his thoughtful and caring nature, his easygoing disposition, his sense of adventure, his thirst for knowledge, his kindness and generosity, his enjoyment of travel, his interest in and engagement with the local and wider community, his creative skills, his Christian faith, his immense and significant contribution to the historical recording and documentation of the world. All these qualities give us glimpses of the nature and character of God, and are things for which we can give thanks to him as we remember Gerald. God wants us to know what he is like, and that, of course, is why he sent Jesus. Because Jesus lived a perfect life, the Bible tells us that when we look at him, we see an exact and complete image of God. The image of a God who loves us all so much that he was willing to take on himself the punishment we deserve by dying on the cross, so that he can offer us the gift of forgiveness. And the image of a God who has now overcome death by rising again, which of course we will be celebrating this coming Sunday, so that he can offer us the gift of eternal life. These are precious gifts that we can all freely receive as we open our hearts to Jesus, acknowledge our human weakness, and ask for his mercy and help and strength in our lives day by day. This is the Christian hope that Gerald knew and embraced. Hope based firmly and solidly on Jesus Christ. Hope in Jesus and through Jesus and because of Jesus. Hope that has the power to challenge and to guide and to transform us. Hope that enables us to find peace in the midst of uncertainty, to find a place of safety when our foundations are shaken, and to hold faith in our hearts alongside questions about mysteries to which as yet we have no answer, but which one day we know we will come to fully understand. This is the hope that Jesus invites each one of us to embrace and to know as we acknowledge our human weakness, ask for the forgiveness we need from our Heavenly Father, and seek his help and strength and guidance and direction in our lives. We were not created to live without reference to the one who made us. He loves us, and he wants to encourage us all to recognize and to live in the light of the hope of eternity, as Gerald did. So let's today thank God, our Heavenly Father, for all the good memories we have of Gerald, some of which have been shared eloquently with us this morning. And let's draw near to our Creator God, so that we can know the comfort of his love and the transforming power of his Spirit with us, not only in our time of grief, but like the psalmist, through all the days of our life. And I'm now going to invite the choir to sing the anthem, Just As I Am. And now our organist, Michael Rhodes, whom Gerald specifically requested, played at this service, is going to play a piece of reflective music, Sunset, which he has arranged himself, during which we can hold our memories of Gerald in our hearts. And now I invite you to stand as we sing our second hymn, O Jesus, I Have Promised.
Assure me to hasten or
control. Oh, speak and make me listen, thou guardian of my soul. Oh, Jesus, thou hast promised to all who follow thee that where thou art in glory, there shall thy servant be. And Jesus, I have promised to serve thee to the end. Oh, give me grace to follow my master and my friend. Oh, let me see thy footmarks and in them plant my own, my hope to follow duly is in thy strength alone. Oh, guide me, call me, draw me, uphold me to the end, and then in heaven receive me, my Savior and my friend. Please be seated as we listen to the first of two pieces of music that Gerald requested for this service before I lead us in prayer. The music is Dido's Lament, When I Laid in the Earth, by Henry Purcell. Let us pray. To the Lord our God, making known our heart's desire for Gerald. God of our journey, You have called us to follow in the way of Christ, even to death. By the victory of the cross, lead Gerald through death to resurrection, where Christ has gone before. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Righteous God, you call us to judgment, the living and the dead, to the place where right and truth prevail. Examine us with love and show Gerald your mercy, for without it none of us may stand. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Saving God, you have promised your salvation to all who trust in you. Bring Gerald with all your saints to your eternal presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Eternal God, you have promised new life to all who are found in Christ. Clothe Gerald with the life of Christ, whom not even death could hold. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God, our Heavenly Father, we pray for ourselves as we pray for Gerald. We stand where earth and heaven meet, where life is brought to death, and death is made the gate to glory. Deliver us from fear and doubt, from despair and unbelief, and bring us into the light of your presence. We remember with thanksgiving Gerald, whom we see no longer, and we hold before you those who mourn, especially all those who were close to Gerald. We pray that casting their care on you, they may know the comfort of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And as we continue in prayer, let us commend Gerald to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Heavenly Father, by your mighty power, you have given us life. And in your love, you offer us new life in Christ Jesus. We now entrust Gerald to your merciful keeping, remembering the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died and rose again to save us, and is now alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen. And I invite you to join me in saying together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And we stand to sing our final hymn, Angel Voices Ever Singing.
Voices ever singing round thy throne of light, angel harps forever ringing, rest not day nor night. Thousands only live to be that thou regardest songs of sinful man? Can we know that thou art near us and wilt hear us? Yea, we can. Yea, we know rejoicest o'er each work of thine. Thou didst ears and hands and voices for thy praise design. Craftsman's art and music's measure for thy pleasure all combine. In thy house, great God, we offer of thine own to thee, and for thine acceptance proffer all unworthily. Hearts and minds and hands and voices in our choices harmony. Honor, glory, might and merit thine shall ever be. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, blessed Trinity, of the best that thou hast given earth and heaven, render thee.
And so now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and in the love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father who has created us, the Son who has redeemed us, and the Holy Spirit who breathes God's life, light, and love into our hearts, rest upon you, remain with you, guard you, guide you, keep you, comfort you, and strengthen you in his service, today and always. Amen. Lord, now let your servant depart in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. So please be seated now. We're going to listen to the final piece of music that Gerald has chosen for this service. Can I suggest that the coffin bearers, if you come and sit on the front pew here, so that the choir can move through past you, and then you can come up after the choir and the standard bearers have gone past to take the coffin out of the church. But before that happens, we're all going to sit and listen to Go in the Name of Christ, Our Lord, by Edward Elgar. Thank you. So could I invite you all to stand now for the exit of the coffin, which will leave through the west door of the church. So those of you who are leaving after the coffin has exited, if you can pause for a moment when you get to the door that you came in through, just for the coffin to come round past there before you begin to leave the church. That would be greatly appreciated. Thank you.